Here's the story. I've been advised by one of my loyal viewers that I should try next design with a lot more event economy and cheaper ice like paper wall so that I can actually afford to rest them in the early to mid game. So I decided to take apart the power shutdown idea and play this deck, which is a very one-dimensional deck. I don't like playing one-dimensional decks, but this, I'll give it a try and I'll see how effective it is. So basically, this event, this deck only has three items. It only has agendas, event economy, and lots of cheap ice. Quandaries, paper walls, Eli's. Basically all the cheap ice I could assemble with my 12 influence. Then throw in a couple of biotic labels for endgame scoring, and I'm good to go. I'm playing against Iain Stirling, so this is a problem because ideally I would like to score an agenda in my hand right now, but I don't want to activate his ability just yet. So eventually I decide that I can start pumping up the agenda in my remote because I feel very safe since it's doubly ice with a foundry and a guard. He attempts the inside job, and that's where guard comes into play. Very, very useful, and keeps him out without him knowing what my outermost piece of ice is. This is very huge. So even if he brings the sentry breaker out, he is not clear to go yet. The only way he can do so is by getting a fem and femming the outer piece of ice. Meanwhile, I continue to slow play my agenda. I definitely do not wish to score it yet, so I'm leaving it there with all three agenda points. I joined to an efficiency committee, and that's my goal time because I really want to score the efficiency committee, which can get me more credits. The extra clicks, I don't have shipment from Sensei to take advantage of it, but I hope to use the extra clicks to draw up to get more credits, etc. It can be very useful. Now, I make a mistake here. I trigger the ABT, and the three cards that were mailed were green level clearance and two agendas, one of which is domestic sleepers. This is another card from upstock that I decided to add in my deck. Very useful because I have 10 2-pointers in my deck. All the three tools, an NEPD contract, and efficiency committees. So these will get me to 6 points easily, but what about my 7th point? This is where domestic sleepers comes in, and it's very useful for a fast deck like mine. Remember, this is a fast deck. All my ice are binary, non-taxing ice that I want to, that will be useless after the early to mid-game stage. So I desperately need to pump out these agendas as quickly as possible. I really had a fantastic start thanks to Celebrity Gift. It allowed me to boost my credits to insane levels, which allows me to score lots of agendas in a row. Right now, I've scored 2 agendas and I'm on my 3rd one. This is looking quite good for me. And the best news is he revealed his hand. He played his alias, passport, and breach. So I know that there is no way he's going to be able to, pardon the pun, breach my defenses in my remote. My remote is the most secure server of them all. And he reveals his deck. He's playing Keep You Poor, Account Siphon, Iain Stirling. Nothing much I can do about that. I know he'll get through regardless, so the question is whether I want to tax him or not. And this is a problem with playing such a one-dimensional deck. I cannot tax him with my ice suite. Roto target costs 2 to break, and Eli does cost... No, that wasn't even an Eli. I believe it was... I forgot what the inner ice was, but either way, it wasn't very taxing. So I just let him through, and so I'll have 3 credits that I can use to score my ABT next turn. Alright, not this turn. I'm in a desperate hurry to score my agenda simply because he has siphon recursion through same old thing. I do not want him to burn away all my precious credits, so I score the agenda while I still can because I know for the rest of this game I'm going to be clamped down on credits with account siphon. And as a result, he is able to keyhole 3 times in succession because I have no credits on hand. This is a risk I intentionally took. I didn't really have a say in it. There wasn't a choice, basically. I could have left the agenda there and credit up, but he would just siphon me and bring me back to 0. I would accomplish literally nothing. So what happens here is he mails 3. He doesn't mail any agendas, but he runs archives anyway and still scores the agendas that I mailed from ABT. Again, a mistake that I made by scoring the ABT and triggering it. So now I get my final agenda into the score area. it's time to close this game, but it's very difficult with no credits left. Perhaps I should have established a greater credit need before I started scoring my agendas. But, well, hindsight is 2020. You never know whether that would be the right move or not. His rig was assembled very quickly. I don't think slow playing was the right play. I think what I did was correct. So now all I can do is to hope that he doesn't find too many agendas through key holding. The thing is, there are 4 2-pointers in the score piles of both of us, and there's another 3 agendas, 2 in my hand and 1 on the board. So there are only 3 agendas left in my deck of 21. The chances of him finding them are pretty low, although he did manage to find 1 NEPD. Alright, so my next move here is Celebrity Gift, but I can't do that because I have 0 credits. So what I do is to click for a credit and advance my agenda one more time. So as long as I make it to next turn, I will win the game because I can advance the last agenda and score it. What I do is, for my third click, I activate the last efficiency committee token to give me 2 clicks which I can use to gain some economy. So with 2 credits, I'm actually sitting at a pretty good place. If he siphons me, well, he's not gaining much. I only lose 2 credits and I can still advance my agenda next turn. If he doesn't siphon me, well, then it's game anyway. So this is looking good so far. He attempts to keyhole and doesn't see anything of use. All he means is my successful demonstration, one of my event-based economies. Now, he liberates the Vitruvius from my hand, which I'm very worried about, and he emergency shutdowns my guy, so he can win the game by scoring in the remote. But my quandary saves the day because I had 2 credits on my last turn thanks to me using the efficiency committee, and thankfully I had the foresight to install the quandary on the remote server and I was able to res it for the win. That was an awfully, awfully close game. He definitely could have won if he had better luck with his key holding, which certainly could have happened. And I definitely could have lost if he made the right play on the last turn. On his last turn, if he account siphoned me, followed by emergency shutdown, followed by stealing my agenda, that would have tripled me to no end. So yes, the same one thing that was on his board could have been utilized better, but otherwise, it was a very close game overall, and it definitely shows the weakness of my deck, which is that it's very one-dimensional and fails to niche strategies like this. When a keyhole comes out, I have no way to defend it once he has all his breakers up. I have no alternative win path. My only route to victory is scoring agendas quickly, and if that doesn't work out, I can just throw my hands in the air, concede, game's over. So I don't like it, but it is good to know that Link's design is still pretty powerful. Definitely a force to be reckoned with because the 3 extra clicks you gain at the start of the turn are so huge. It allows you to score agendas so quickly, and it really forces the runner into a very pressurizing situation when they have to get everything out before they lose the game. Alright, so that's all I have. Thanks for watching, and happy net running.